brothers and sisters, I believe God has spoken a really weighty and hard word to my spirit regarding spiritual authority and those in it. I see modern church culture denying the tremendous responsibility and accountability that teachers and leaders have in this realm in favor of some perverse form of grace that demands nothing of us and leaves us unchanged and unaccountable for the actions of our flesh.
But this is our time.
So we resolve to walk in the glory of the full gospel and to expect of ourselves that the grace of God, which has appeared to all men, is able to teach us to say no to ungodliness. Here's what I'm saying. Matthew 16 says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I am?" So they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." He says, "You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." This is the moment in which Jesus establishes Peter in spiritual authority as the first church leader. And the first piece of advice or direction in regards to this office is, "I give you the keys to the kingdom, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." I believe this is a word about something I'll call corporate impartation. What I mean by that is this. If those in authority bind something in their own life or on earth, it will be bound in the kingdom or in the atmosphere in which they hold authority. So if a pastor stands on stage and preaches purity and preaches holiness, but in secret is in an adulterous relationship or is secretly addicted to pornography, regardless of the words he speaks, he has relinquished spiritual authority of his congregation to the spirit of lust. And in his church, you will see many people, in spite of the sermons preached, falling prey to this ferocious and deadly spirit. We must demand radical and profound consecration from those in spiritual leadership. Because what is allowed to take authority in their life, by extension, is given authority in the lives of every single person that is under their guidance. That's why Jesus could say in Matthew 12, when talking about spiritual warfare, "How can anyone enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man? Then he can rob his house. He can be the strongest man in the place, but if he gets tied up, the whole house is in danger." So I say to you leaders, you heads of your household, for the sake of your house, your congregation, your community, stay focused and alert, knowing that there is temptation all around, because what you allow in can ravage your community. But in the victories you win, you will claim victory for all those under you in the same way that Christ claimed victory for you. And now I say to you, the family of believers, you hold up and support your leadership. Commit yourself to pray for them daily. Set yourself to build them up in the faith and fight for them in the spirit. May we each, in our private heart, resolve and stand firm as Joshua did when he said, "You can choose this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." And where the head goes, the rest of the body will follow.